You can now follow me on all my social media platforms to find out who my latest guest will be. And don't forget to click the subscribe button and the notifications button so you're notified for when my next podcast goes live.
As I come off the pitch straight away, I just see some fella just glaring at me and goes, Lacey, drugs test, I knew I'd failed it. I knew what I'd done on the weekends, you know what I mean? What? No, your mate's going to Glastonbury there. Are you going? I went, nah, I'm got a ticket on that. He went, you fucking go. You just won a gold medal in a big massive tournament you've been training for 4 months for. Fucking go and enjoy yourself, lad. Fucking is what it is. So goes down to Glastonbury, gets nicked. And then fucking hell, from the space of playing in the Football League on Sky against Burnley and doing dead well and scoring Golden Month on Sky. Fucking hell, how long ago? I'm fucking banned from football career over. And I'm fucking in prison, what? And as everyone's leaning over looking, some kid's hot sugar water has just melted this kid's face. And the kid was the wrong kid, he owed a debt. As it worked out, he owed a debt. This was the first day, so I was thinking, fucking hell, it's going off in here. Just melted his face, and then he's walked back over to him like, is that all right? Do we not owe money no more? And they went, that's the wrong kid, and this kid is next door but wants a job. Just going, ah! Obviously, his face melting with those boiling sugar water. James, I can remember getting the call. I can remember my dad fucking telling my mum. I can remember my mum punching the wall, screaming. This scream, and I opened my door, and she's punching the wall, just breaking her hands. Both her hands are broke off it.
Boom, we're on. And today's guest, we've got Paddy Lacey. How are you, Paddy boy?
Sand. Great. Sand.
Just fascinating story, Paddy boy. Professional footballer, banned for taking coke, sent to prison for forged notes.
Yeah.
Not better place to be, brother, than this podcast. Welcome for this story, bro.
Yeah, most definitely. Yeah.
How are you?
No, sand. Yeah. It's a colourful past that we'll definitely get into, but. Yeah, I'm made up that I'm coming out the other end now.
Yeah, you can see that. You can see that with your post. You can see what you're doing. Everybody's behind you as well. Everybody loves those stories. That's why this podcast is so popular, because it's fucked up stories that majority of people do change, which is also a great thing. Yeah. You're living proof of that. Like, you had a career ahead of you in the football. Obviously, you've had a few obstacles like most of the kids in Liverpool as well, all around the UK, in fact, that... There's always temptation there where the temptation...
Especially in Liverpool.
Yeah, it always tends to lead the way. But shout out to the Scousers. Love the Scousers. These are crazy bastards. Don't get me wrong, but all fucking great people, all a good breed. And first of all, glad to have you on, bro.
Nice one, Jay, yeah.
But as you know, I always go back to the start of my guest, Paddy. Where you grew up and how it all began.
So I grew up in Crosby, in one of the nicer areas in Liverpool. Me and Ma's from Eton, me half fella's from Dingle, and I think they didn't really want to bring kids up where they was from to remain up with everything that goes with it. So me mum's granddad moved to Crosby from Eton, so they used to come up and see him and said, it's nice round here, we'll bring the kids round here. And I was one of two then. Sister is 2 years older. Me mum and dad end up having two more kids, Lewis and Shea, who promising young footballers, like the journey me and you have been on when we were younger, there at Man U and Barnsley. So it was just a normal childhood, I'd say. Nothing but happy memories, do you know what I mean? Fighting, playing football in the park, just doing normal things, do you know what I mean? As every Scouse kid does.
How's the wee brother getting treated playing for the other side of the Reds?
Do you know what? He's been there since 5 years old. I should have signed for Man U when I was a kid, but I signed for Liverpool. And he's been there since he's five, so he supports Man U and everything now, because they've doted after him, they've looked after him. He lives in Manchester. He's only 15, well, he's 15 in April, and he's been the top player. He plays in England. So, like, he just supports Man U. There's nothing we can do about it. It's hard. It's a bitter pill to swallow, because he'll come home singing Man U songs after coaching him with all the lads, and we're just like, what's happened? But, you know, they look after him, so fantastic.
Yeah, good luck to him. How is... Where does that breed of talent come from in the family? Clearly got something in the blood.
Yeah, my half-fella played for Liverpool till he was 17. He had a few schoolboy boxing fights when he was a kid. Naughty in school, so his parents said, you know, you're not boxing no more, you're naughty in school. Stopped him boxing. Football till 17, got fucked off at Liverpool, and then he didn't want to play for no one else. I think he went to a few little teams, and he said, the buzz had gone, son. He said, so we went straight back in the boxing gym at 18. Boxed for like 3-4 years. and then said he was going to turn pro, win a world title, all the palaver that comes with it. But he met me, man, she was to blame. That's what he says. Yeah.
Somebody's got to get blamed, aren't they? What were you like at school?
Do you know what? I could talk my way out of a room and no doors. The amount of times I was sat there, always older lads, never fighting with lads my age, always kind of looked after our lads. With, you know, a couple of lads beside me who were a bit older and I'd duffed them up. But always taught me way out of it. I've had teachers' sons pop up to me recently, Joe, you know, with the Instagram and all that, saying, I'm just here with, you know, your art teacher. She says you was, you know, fantastic kid, always fighting, but you a decent lad, so.
Was what age did you start getting into football?
Football, I started quite late, considering the kids start early now, about eight, something like that. I was at Samia within a year. Then Liverpool, the following year, they bought me from Tramia. And then my aunt followed was a bit of an headache. I was his little superstar, do you know what I mean? So he thought I should play the year above, I should play every game. And, you know, you're at Liverpool, big football club, and he probably caused some friction there with the coaches and things. You know, but it was nothing but an happy childhood. I felt sorry for my sister. She never really... I love school. I bounced up every morning. I couldn't wait to get to school, loved it, but she got bullied quite a bit at school, do you know what I mean? And it was like chalk and cheese. Everyone says, you and your sister chalk and cheese, because she found it hard in school. She hated it, she didn't want to go. She cried that she was 2 years older, she cried that she didn't want to go, and I'd be skipping out the door, do you know what I mean? And so there was always tension, whereas, you know, she was getting bullied, I'd have to fight her battles, done that loads of times, do you know what I mean? Looking after, and I've always looked after her since. She's a great person, do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Was how old did you, what position did you play at Liverpool? Did your positions change through the years, or did it stick to the same?
Yeah, no, I was always a centre forward then.
Did you?
Yeah, I was a centre forward as a kid, and that's what they bought me as Tamia. I mean, Liverpool bought me off Tamia as a centre forward. Somewhere along the line, I think it was my dad's bright idea that I was a centre midfielder because I could tackle. So yeah.
What happened after Liverpool?
So Liverpool. Little bit of a story with that. My half fellas, he's like just causing all friction with the managers, and they just signed me, they just bought me, and I weren't there that long, and he was telling them we should have signed for Man U, but Liverpool Football Club don't want to hear that, you know, this kid, promising kid should have signed for Man U. So it was about 6 months and I was out the door. I'd signed for a couple of years. Conor Cody was in my team, John Flanagan, Dale Jennings, good players, and so then I was playing Sunday League. Lo and behold, my dad already had a Sunday League team. So I'd come back out the academy system to his Sunday League team. He was made up. My teammates were made up because we'd run the show then. And we were playing this team. What was they called? I won't even mention them because it's like it's bringing someone's thing into it. But they had this lad centre mid. He was a big, massive unit. And he was a big bullying cunt. He ended up just recently getting done for it. He's 13 then, and he was out raping prostitutes then on historical crimes and all. It's mad. He was about 15 stone at 13. So I'm saying to my dad the night before, I've just come out of Liverpool, probably 3 weeks, 4 weeks. I said, Dad, I want to smash him in half tomorrow, but if it goes off because he's a big bullying cunt, make sure you're with me. So he hits this kid with a tackle. Well, he was like a man, he was 13. And my leg just kept coming back to me, and I fucking broke my own leg in the tackle. So I jumped up, my dad's the manager, you're playing on, son, are you playing on? I went, yeah, I'm just trying to get going. Joe, like Conor McGregor's, when he's standing on that leg, but it's broke. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to jog, and for a couple of minutes, he's like, are you playing on or what? I went, Dad, I can't. I went, my leg's fucked. So when I was young, because he wouldn't let me box, James, I always wanted to box. I was always fighting. I always wanted to show him I was tough, but I could only do that via the football, on the football pitch. So never stayed down for tackle, tough in the tackle, always tough. And sat at the side of the pitch and my ankle ballooned so like that. So he phones an ambulance, and the paramedics come, and they went, nah, we don't think he's done anything. Joe, you know, he doesn't seem in that much pain. My dad went, no, he can take pain. I know he's only 13, but... So one of the parents kicked off, said, you're not taking him in the ambulance. Joe, you know, look at the size of his ankle. So they went, all right, we'll take him. And lo and behold, I'd snapped my ankle, but I took no gas and air in the ambulance with my arm. I don't know why, mad way of thinking. I think I'll show him how tough I am. So I'm laying in the bed for 4 hours, been x-rayed, and some nurse come over to me. He's like, look, I've had a look at your sheet, you're 13, 14, and you know, you've had no medication, and you snapped your leg like 6 hours ago. But it was all to try and show me that I was tough, which is a mad thing, do you get what I mean? And I went, fucking hell, no. And he come over to me and went, I hope you're not taking medication to try and prove to me that you're tough. I went, yeah. He went, you fucking donuts, what I mean? So then he gave us all painkillers then, but it was like something in me then, so to try and show your dad how tough. Weird, I don't know.
Did you look up to your dad? Was your dad not that tough? Yeah. Tough on you?
Ex-boxer, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, he's seen the potential in you.
Yeah, so he kept me away from boxing. He seen me fight in the street. He used to send me to school, Joe, when I was a kid. Joe, your sister's getting bullied. You've got to go senior school, even when I was in primary school. Go to that school, and whoever said something to your sister, you've got to go and weigh them in, do you know what I mean? And that was the norm for us. My dad's like a bit of a fucking caveman in that respect. If there's a dispute, he solves it with his fist, do you know what I mean? He's old school, so he kept me away from the boxing and just said, you know, stick to this footy, son, you've got potential. Everyone loves my dad, do you know what I mean? From where we're from in Liverpool, I get more messages about my dad than me. How's your dad, fella? He is a proper legend from where we're from. Everyone loves him. He's got a big heart, my dad, fella. He's a funny guy, but, you know, he's tough, he's old school.
Has it calmed down a bit with your other brothers playing football, or do you see the same?
Well, he hasn't calmed down in general, no. He's fucking... he's round the bend.
Maybe that's what you get it from.
Yeah, it's definitely. I do believe that it, you know, gets passed along the line. And what's in him's in me, yeah. And you know, all his side of the family, they've all got short tempers. I think I'm snapping out of it. I'm maturing now, my temper's going, but I'm totally in charge of their footy careers. He reckons he ruined mine. He's probably right. I definitely didn't help, but I'm in charge of this, do you know what I mean?
So how long were you injured for?
So that knocked me back about 6 months. So I come out of a fantastic football club, Liverpool, and then I was out for 6 months, a year, something like that. I needed two operations on it to get it straight. And then I was playing catch up. Then all them lads who, you know, your Connor Cody's, your John Flanagan's, your Dales, they'd really kicked on in the year I'd been out, and I went frail. I was weak because I'd been sitting on the couch for a year and I weren't quite the player that I was, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, between the ages of 12 and 16 is crucial years for your development.
Yeah,
well, you can kind of know between the ages of like 14 and 17 who's going to kick on. It's not the talent that makes it, it's the consistency. So a year out potentially sets you back 3 years. Playing under 13 at 14, you can still play under 16s, under 17s, but if you're going back a year out, it's a hard battle. But did you obviously got back.
So I got back and I got to Blackburn, but it was more on the back of how good I was, you know, a couple of years previous, because everyone was after me then. So I was kind of in my shell then a little bit. You know what I mean? I was kind of probably because I didn't believe in myself and I weren't the same player. I was around all top players, do you know what I mean, at Blackburn. So was kind of within myself, and then I went to Sheffield Wednesday. Never got my scholarship at Blackburn, and then I went to Sheffield Wednesday, but I was better than the Sheffield Wednesday lad, so that come back then. So me kind of, I'm outspoken. I was a bit of a, I always thought of myself as a leader, and love Sheffield. The Yorkshire people were tough people. The lads were tough. They were a great set of lads. And yeah, it was fantastic. Sheffield Wednesday, loved it there.
Where did you go after them?
Bradford City. So then again, my half fella didn't learn from his mistakes at Liverpool. So always passing messages, your manager done this, he played you in this position, he's done that, make sure you tell him tomorrow. So I'd be speaking to my dad every day, be burning my head out. Did you speak to him today? Because I was living away, obviously. No, dad, I haven't spoken to him. Go in that office tomorrow and you tell him. So basically, I'm just telling this manager what my dad wants to tell him, to get him in. So all friction caused, and the fella, Joe, it's easy in hindsight, innit? He knew his shit. He played for St Johnstone, played under Sir Alex Ferguson and Man United, Sean McCauley. In retrospect now, he was a proper clued up fella, but I was listening to the wrong person. I was listening to my half fella. Do you get what I mean? And in the end, he gave me this like one chance. He always used to say, this youth team, remember Bad Lads Army on ITV? Mm-hmm. He used to say, we've got a Bad Lads Army in this youth team. And you're the fucking ringleader, because I was telling all the lads, he's a fucking player to me, he doesn't have a clue. But that's what my dad was telling me, do you get what I mean? So he sat me down one day, we played Everton, played well, and he went, look, me and you have been arguing for 18 months here, but I'm still willing to give you your pro, because you're good enough. Joe, will you be here Monday? And I went, I fucked off, and I went to Leeds instead. And I shook his hand and everything, and it fucking hurts me that I looked someone in the eye, shook their hand, and still fucking done what my dad said. There should have been a point when I went, dad, do you know what I mean? He gives out the pro contract. He's saying he's giving me one Monday, fuck off. But my half fellow was like, it's not him writing, fuck him off. He's an abed, he's this, he's that.
Yeah. But, my dad was the same. When I was with Hibs, he used to do the same. It was a lot of private school kids played and they were signing S forms. So he was, when he used to stand outside, he was always shouting and swearing. And I'm thinking, for fuck's sake, that you get kind of embarrassed, but he just tried to give me that extra edge just to let people know that I had support limit. As well. Yeah. And then obviously they clearly don't like it because people, you've got all the yes men around the managers, all the other kids, dads all nice and kissing their ass. Obviously your dad was the same, like he's trying to do your best for you, but he's making it worse.
Yeah, well, making it worse. John, he probably loved me a bit too much. I was his little superstar, do you get what I mean, at Liverpool. Remember playing Everton, I was on the bench at the start of the game. There's four quarters, do you know what I mean? You're going to play. He's walking around the pitch in front of all the parents and went, come on, you're not on the bench for no one. Playing for Liverpool, do you know what I mean? And you're just like, what? I'm getting dragged by the arm. But, Then it was into non-league. Then non-league was fucking hell. It was funny non-league. So well, I'm still here now, signed for a good club in Altrincham. But first, my half fella, he's helped me so much. James, he doesn't ask how you are. He asks, have you trained? Do you know what I mean? He's obsessed with it. Not really his own training now. He's a little bit old, but he always knew that I had to train every day, and so. I was down in the dumps, I'd had a few injuries at Bradford, I went to Bradford, had two knee ups, pulled my thigh twice, never broke into the first team, although I was a pro. So then I went into non-league then, and that summer my half fella said, right son, this is what you need to do, you've been injured all season, we'll get fit. And he was on the track with me 6 o'clock, three times a week, 6 o'clock in the morning, he had to go and fit a load of floor, do you know what I mean? And I got paid up, I think about February, off Bradford, got all the rest of my contract paid up. So as a kid, I thought at that point, fucking hell, I've got about $7,000 in the bank or whatever it was. I'm fucking rich, do you know what I mean? And he got me in the van then. He went, nah, you're not sitting at home waiting, for opportunities. You get in the van and learn something. So I learned flooring, then I've got my own business now, North Liverpool flooring. So it's the best thing I ever done, really. That football didn't have a hold on me then. Whereas, at the end of your contract, you've got to go and find another team. You've got to drop down a level. You don't know your wages for the next year. And it was always living with that, anxiety, that fucking hell, what, am I going to be here next year? Is this manager having me or is he not? Well, fuck that. I've got a job now and I've got a trade and I'll always have work.
Yeah.
So it did solve a few issues, having a trade and being on the tools. Yeah. And then I went to Barrow. There's a few little funny stories in Barrow. Barrow was a... fucking when I joined him, we was really struggling in the Conference North and we kind of went on a journey, but the first story which I've put up on my Instagram was have you seen the pictures where there's all fans, I'm duffing up fans?
No.
So we play in the FA Cup and it was an international break. We played a team I'm only 19 here, no 20 I was, and we played a team three leagues lower, Atherstone, I think it's like Birmingham ways or Coventry. And we turned up to this little shitty shed of a ground, in the fourth qualifier of the FA Cup or third. I was like, fucking hell, there's a fair few fans here. Who the fuck are these, And I was on the bench this game. And at half-time, you warm up with your teammates on the ball. And you just seen all fans bailing round towards our fans, but all the Barrow fans were quite old. So I was saying, mate, they're not going round for the fight. So I've plodded over with the ball, seen all these fans just run in, start weighing in. These are Barrow fans. So this fella must have been 70 years of age and he's just getting weighed in by all young lads, but I'm on the pitch and they're kind of up on the stand. So I've put my arms around this fella to stop these, and as I turn, the pitches are all, they were on the Daily Mail. I've turned and then there's all fellas on the pitch looking at me. So obviously, I'm a young Scouse lad, you're not running, are you? And I've just stood. And they've come towards, boom, sat one on his ass, it's all on pitches, boom, it's another one. But then there's too many of them, I've had to back off. Not, I remember saying, first one that comes, you're getting sat on your ass, just moody down the tunnel. So then, we're sat in the changing rooms, they're all footy lads, they're all nice lads. But my manager was a nutter, Dave Bayliss, he was right up for it, Scouts fella from, I think it's from Aylward, Dave. And he was like, look boys, there's no plod at this game. We'll be fighting our way out of here. You could hear them all down the tunnel. So then about 10 minutes goes by and this steward comes in, this woman. She was a young girl. She went, look, whoever was fighting outside, now you need it. So I thought it's police. So it comes outside into the end of the tunnel. Just massive fat fella with, them warm-up poles with the big spike. He's just stood with it like that. So I'm like, what's happening? All right, mate. And he goes, you just hit my fucking son. He had like a Cockney accent. So I was just went bang, hit him with the left hook. So what, James? He didn't really budge. He was about 25 stone, big fat face. So fucking, I got dragged in by my manager. He went, lad, you're going to cause murder. So then we had to wait like 45 minutes for police to come to the game. And then we sat on the bench and they're all banging on the bench. Lacey, you're getting it. Paddy Lacey, you're fucking this. So I kept standing up on the bench. Standing on the bench going, listen, you big dickhead. I've just filled your mate and I'll smash your head in at the end of the game. And then my manager's ended up bringing me on going, Paddy, you're causing chaos. So he's brought me on the pitch and fucking, they're all screaming all shit. Then at the end of the game, I flew over to the bench like, what was you saying, mate? Come on. And then all plod have got hold of me then. And took me off, but that was the first like thing in non-league where it was just fucking nuts. Chaos. But then the lad who's on the pitches with me, Greg, oh, I hate to name him, when we come into the changing room, he's went to me, Greg, lad, what about us? Then we were swinging, bodies were dropping, and I'm just like, it happens quick, there is a fight, it's just all about. I was like, oh yeah, it's right. So we live locally, so we never got on the coach home. So when we got on the coach, it was all live because it was a big thing. There was all fighting at matches with players. We looked on the pitches, he's fucking running away as I'm fighting. He fucking left me, man.
How was your temper on the pitch in like previous seasons, previous teams? Did it start getting worse as the team started to decline, do you think?
Well, we was on the up then.
Yeah.
So we started then, but I used it to my advantage. I always remember like an old army saying, I always relate loads of things back to the army that, you know, like all the disappointments, you can turn them into energy. So if someone had done me with a tackle or we were 1-0 down, I kind of, instead of sulking, moaning, and I kind of just got angry and then ran around more and tried to make something of it, to get what I mean? So, but the next couple of years, 3 years at Barrow, climbed the leagues, won the league, done all right in the conference, which then led me to Accrington then, which was, you know, finally in the Football League. It was, what, 22 years hard work to get to, you know, playing the likes of your Portsmouths, your, you know, big clubs, yeah, where you feel like a footballer then.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? And it took me 22 years. Should have done it sooner. Some of my players, you know, played Burnley then on Sky, playing against John Flanagan, who's a mate who I played with at 9. He'd played by that point. He played fucking 40, 50 times for Liverpool then. So I was kind of playing catch up and was looking like, you know, I'm here now. I'm 22, but you know, I've got to move in me at least. Let's get to, you know, earning that big money in even, you know, the Championship, Premier League. I wanted to do it. So I was working that hard at the time, but I had these little problems where, you know, I was a floor layer by trade. I was living my life like a floor layer, Jay. Do you know what I mean? I was going out drinking, taking drugs, using that, as we spoke about before, escapism. If I had a bad week, the only way I knew how to process it was by drinking ale and going taking drugs. That was all I knew. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
With my environment. So started off well at Accrington, doing really well in training and that, but he kind of had it fixed on his two centre mids that done really well for him. So finally got myself in the team for Portsmouth. He started me, rang me. Oh no, he pulled me just before the game and he went, look, you're starting today, phone your dad. So I phones me off and says, look, I'm starting Portsmouth for home, big game. And my dad went, lad, I've took on all work. You haven't played the last, like, you've come off the bench 20 minutes. You know, you haven't played the last, I'm working, there's nothing I can do. I went, oh, fuck's sake, dad. I went, I'm playing anyway. So he tells a fella he's doing the floor and says, look, mate, my son plays Rackington, could you get Soccer Sports on or get you know, the radio on? The fella gets it on, he was into his footy. So it's 0-0, 80-something minute. Fucking turn, bend this goal in, fucking unbelievable. So the fella runs to me dad in the, as he's fitting the phone, goes, you're not going to believe this, he's just, it went to them live, said it was some unbelievable. My dad's like, you're fucking joking.
Yes.
So
he must have been buzzing.
Oh, he was made up, you know, but he missed it, man. And then I got called a month for that on Sky.
Big bastard's giving you shit for years, mate.
Yeah.
Causing havoc.
And he doesn't even get
your
plane,
he doesn't turn up to your big game in years.
He still gets stick about it now. So I was starting to fucking hit a bit of form then I forced my way into the team, was doing well, but brings me on to failing drugs test, doesn't it?
How old were you?
I'm 22, I think, yeah.
At the time?
Yeah, 22 years old. So I was in the team and then he kind of wanted this centre midfielder back. I can't really, you know, I did deserve to keep my place, but these two centre midfielders, they were older than me. They were like 31, 32, both of them. Joe, they played 500 games. They really knew what they were doing, James. Do you know what I mean? Experienced, played at that level for years. So I was the third choice. So you got me out of centre mid. Then I kind of made it home at right back, but we had a kid on loan from Bristol City who had to play. So I was out there. I was constantly in football. Don't know whether you had it. You build yourself up to the weekend. If you play shit, I'd just go in a mad low. I'd just be fuming, like, fuck, didn't play. Obviously, then drinking ale, taking drugs. So I've been out one weekend. He dropped me. I played well. Then he dropped me. And I always remember the assistant manager come up to me and went, I know you're going to really feel hard done by. Because you've been doing really well. But, you know, just stick with it. You're gonna give him, like, a point where you can't say no. Do you know what I mean? How well you're playing. But I remember just thinking, fuck. So I hope someone's sniffing around me, but I was getting told that there was clubs all sniffing around me anyway. I'm fucking used right off when I get given half a chance for doing this, do you know what I mean? Always leave me off the team. As soon as I get a chance, I'm fucking used off. And then I went out that weekend. He rings me. I never turned off a trainer on the Monday. And he rings me on a Tuesday and says, look, Pad, we're playing Hartlepool away. I think someone was struggling with the groin. Someone, you know, you mightn't start, but you're definitely going to get some game times. Will you please? And he half, like, not begged me, but he made me not. I said, Gaffer, I'm not well. I'm fucking, like, basically two fingers. And then he made me feel like I was obliged to go. So I turns up, and then at half time, we come out, this the sub second half, and then someone just looked along the bench. They not think nothing of it, to the end. They went, there's all drug testers here. Fucking hell. I just felt fucking terrible straight away. I just thought, no, please, God, no. So he brings me on the pitch then, last half an hour, as he said he would. But I must have drank, I'm telling you now, James, 4 litres of water just straight away, thinking, fucking, I want to piss water here. Comes on the pitch, couldn't move because I had a big fucking belly on me with all the water. And then as I come off the pitch, straight away, just see some fella just glaring at me and goes, Lacey, drugs test. I knew I failed it. I knew what I'd done on the weekend, do you know what I mean? What? Still makes me fume, do you know what I mean? And then you're in this room. He comes into the changing rooms. You don't listen to the team talk. The man mark you. There's no escaping. Some players do. Just go, look, mate, I'm not taking this drug test. See you later and just walk out. But for some reason, I didn't. But, you know, it was all meant to happen. What happened? So, sits down and fucking wait for me piss. Didn't take long, obviously drank a load of water, just shitting myself. Then gets on the coach with the lads and everyone's looking at me like, you're all right there. I must have looked, do you know what I mean? Must have went grey. You're all right there. I was like, yeah. But it took them 3 weeks, James, to give me the fucking results. So as every week passed, I was thinking, fucking sound, yeah, that was a close escape and I'll never do that again, do you know what I mean? So, he just phoned me 3 weeks later, Coley, the manager, and I was back in the team then. Funny enough, I'm fucking playing dead well. And he phoned me, he went, all right, Paddy, you're all right. He went, are you sitting down? I went, sitting down, what are you on about? He went, you failed the drugs test, son. So I just went, fuck, because I'd half forgot about it, if I'm honest, because it took 3 weeks. Speaking to all other lads that I'd confided in and went, look, they went, nah, I took it one time because all footballers, they're all young lads. People will go out and, you know, make mistakes. You know, fucking, I had it once on a Sunday and got drug tested on a Tuesday and nothing happened to me. So I was kind of thinking, Joe, close fucking call, but I've got away with it. And then he hit me with it then, do you know what I mean? That I've failed the drugs test and you fucking, that was a load, do you know what I mean? And fucking all well fell apart then. But you're totally exiled from that point. You can't go into training. They can't have nothing to do with you, which is, I think, is ridiculous. The rules are, James, that, like, if I get caught, so say they would have come to the football club on the Monday and had to turn up to training, you get a rehabilitation order, just you, the FA and the club find out, so you just have a sit-down. Not a sit-down, but they inform the club and they say, look, we're going to put on this rehabilitation for them. And the club, they can sack you if they want, or they can say, no, he's a promising young kid, you know, he's made a mistake. And then you rehab and you learn, you know, how to cope with these things and not put yourself in certain situations and all stuff like that. So, but when you get caught with it in your system in a game, this is ridiculous. Straight away, you are out of 4-year ban, even though it's Charlie. Do you get what I mean? Because they say it's a stimulant. So straight away, that's the first thing. You're banned for 4 years as it stands. You know, you need mitigating circumstances. You need to talk to them about, you know, It went for Joe Sport and Performance. So who the fuck would do that? I don't know why it is like that. And then that gets it to 2 years. So you're talking 2 years I was banned for. And then, so I spoke to the PFA. I was like, look, I only fucking had it that weekend because I've been dropped. And they send you to psychologist, psychiatrist. It's all a bit of a, it's all a blag. It's the FA, the PFA, they decide what they're going to do with you. The PFA is supposed to be on your side. So Professional Footballers Association, you pay into that every year, every footballer does, but they're kind of in bed with the FA. I don't know, it was mad. It was just a mad setup.
Did you have many drug tests before that?
I never had one.
Do you have a question that it may be, have maybe been a setup?
Well, yeah, I definitely do know, do you know what I mean? And I do know who rang them.
Somebody stuck you in?
Yeah, someone defo stuck me in, but he weren't trying to get me. So I mean, he weren't trying to get me because there was a group of scouts at the time and one of them had fell out with him, this fella, and kicked off on him and that, and I just thought, he thought, get him away from this club, do you get what I mean? Because the fella, I don't know, but I don't believe he was trying to get me. But it's like Judas, this fella, when this drug test happened, he phoned every day, he was phoning me half hour, do you get what I mean? Oh, you know, I just blew himself up.
That makes somebody look guilty, though.
That's football for you, though, James. And like in the football world, I've met plenty of good mates and they're good lads, but it was always kind of snidey and no honest answers with managers. And everyone was always just sly. And like, if a manager doesn't fancy me as a player, he says, look, son, Joe, I'm thick skinned enough. I'm not quite having you. Can you find another club? Sound, yeah. That's right, sound, some other manager loved me. Football was always, I've always seen it as a bit snide, and I'm dead honest. And
yeah, it's cliquey.
Yeah, if I'm going to upset you with what I say, well, man up, that's the way I see it, do you know what I mean? So, they fucked me then. I just got to the Football League. I fucked myself, but, you know, I'm not the only person to do that, and I'm not saying that people should go out and do it or whatever, but if I'd have been given some rehabilitation and Joe some help from the FA, if they'd have turned around and went, look, he's a first-time offender and it's his first drug test. We could have got him at training. There's no sense to it, but he's getting a two-year ban now and you're fucking up his whole career. Not only, like, what job do you know that they can get you sacked? Fair play to Accrington. They paid me till the end of the season because it took like 6 months in order me to go to Wembley and find out what they're doing with me. So it took them like 6 months and Accrington just said, we're going to keep playing you and hopefully they look fondly on you. They don't bring it out in the press and we're going to give you a new, we're going to look after you, to get them in. So thank God for that, to get them in.
So they stuck by you though?
They stuck by me. They were sound until it come out in the papers and they just went, look, we're already a small club. I think in years gone by, there was some type of thing with betting. Maybe 10 scandal. Years before me, yeah, with some of the Accrington players. So they just bumped. But when I first joined Accrington, what I should have done is I should have been more pally with the chairman. Andy was a good fella. We had a fella, Billy Key, up front, who went through depression, but he was dead. He was getting paid and he never turned up for about 6 months because he was dead pally with the chairman and the chairman knew. So he's going through whatever he's going through. But the chairman thought I was some nutter, but I weren't. In the pre-season game, we ended up having a fight with another fucking... We played the team in pre-season. I won't name him because I don't know the fella, but I knew this fella from 6 or 7 years previous. I played in... I was on trial with his team and his nickname was Joe Greenmile, John Coffey.
The big guy from Greenmile.
He was a big, massive unit. He looked like him as well. And I'm playing for Accrington, my first game pre-season. This kid has just hit me with a tackle, near snapped my leg. So I've tried to play on and I couldn't. And as I come off, John Coleman, he's been in the game 40s, he went, that's the worst tackle I've ever seen in my whole life. That, you know, he said, oh, your leg hasn't snapped in two, I don't know. So the kid was a scouser. So I goes over to him at half time, says, I'll fucking have a word with him. I said, lad, what was that? Look at the state of my leg. He said, lad, I've just rolled off a beach, got off Daldy yesterday, I apologise. So we're coming down the tunnel and then this big cunt, he was their strength and conditioning coach, ex-player. He's shouting all shit. What's he fucking saying to you there? So I looked back down the tunnel, I'm like, what, who are you talking to? But all these Accrington players don't really know me. So then my manager, who's probably 60, John, puts his hand around him and goes, calm down, big fella, then. You know, he's only... He meant anyone puts their hands down me in this tunnel, you're fucking, I'll knock you out or something. So I'm like, see you big dickhead, I'll come and see you as soon as I get out of this tunnel, I'll come and see you. So I walks past their bench, I'm hobbling after getting a shower, and says, "You big dickhead, don't be shouting down all fucking tunnels and all that, you big knobhead." So he jumps up then, he's all screaming, there's all fans behind, and my two new managers have only been playing for them for about 3 weeks. They say, "Sit down, will you please? Fucking causing all trouble." So I thought, fucking won't say nothing, won't, you know what I mean? I look like a bit of a cunt. So at the end of the game, I hobbles over to him. I says, "Lad, forget about it, it was only a tackle." And he went, "I'm not shaking your hand looking down on me." So he puts my hand round his waist. I goes, "Look, lad, if we start fighting on this pitch, it's getting split up in 10, 15 seconds, less, do you know what I mean, all lads?" I said, "But if you want to go on a walk with me, if you think you're out because you've got all these big, massive muscles, come on a little walk with me and we'll see how you get on." He goes, "What?" So, but I didn't know, unbeknown to me, my assistant manager, Jimmy Bell, he'd seen me having this conversation. He was right behind me. So I went, put my hands, "Let's go." And he went, "Fucking right." So me and him are walking off this pitch, this big unit, but I'm limping. So then he grabbed my arm, Jimmy Bell, and he went, "Lad, are you sure here? Do you want to do this?" I went, "Lad, these big fellas, they can't fight, they're full of water." So then we walked, we goes past this changing room. We're walking towards the exit. His arse starts to go, "No, James," and he turns around. He's like, "Hey, look, I'm not a player no more. I can't be doing all this fighting." I went, "Look, your arse is going. Fucking, it's time to go." So then we walks outside, goes outside, just flattened him. He didn't knock them clean out. So one of their players had seen us all walking off. So there's a big crowd walking through this big centre half with his top off, runs out as if he's going to do something, then sees his mate Polak and just goes. So he goes in and then. That's the first thing the chairman heard about me. Do you get what I mean? Fucking hell, one of our new signings just knocked out this fella. But I spoke to him on the way home. I said, "Look, chairman," I said, "where I'm from, you know, I put my hand out to shake his hand. He fucked me off in front of everyone." So that happens where we're from. And he was all right then, but he'd get on the team coach and, you know, he'd look at me a bit like, do you know, and he shouldn't have. And then I failed the drugs test. I've ended up going to jail. So that was kind of Accrington. They did get me back after I'd been to prison. But they were saying, "Go and do like a year's here so we know that you're going to stay out of trouble and all that." So I couldn't wait that time. But the rehab, if they're the
game. You're a pure liability, bro, if I'm honest, mate. How the fucking set you up for a drug test, mate, if you're constantly fighting and causing it every fucking week?
Don't want to think
the
back.
The director sitting in the bus thinking he doesn't want to sit in his own team bus because you're there.
Oh, mate. So all the Accrington fans, they're obviously leaving the stadium at the same time. They've seen me. They're writing it. And that's how he got word of it, saying, "Just seen one of our players knock this fella out." But, yeah.
Did you think you'd bring a lot of that shit on yourself as well, though, looking back at it?
I always, Joe, what? My thing is, I don't know why it is, I always want to stand up to bullies. I've never been a bully, never done it in my life, but, or anyone that any bullied, anyone, I think it was more to do sister. With my sister. So I had this deep thing where people thought, like, if they could talk down to people or, so any bullies, I'm always the one, and my beard's on switch. So if you're in place and there's this loud mouth dickhead, which there is in every bar, my beard knows straight away. She's like, "I want to go," because I'll end up saying to him, "You fucking big knobhead."
Do you feel as if you've always got something to prove then?
I had, until I started boxing. I always felt like I did. I was always fighting with Dorman and fucking hell. Always fucking fighting. That's like when I look back at my childhood, I don't remember any footy matches, just all the fights I had. I remember my handful of coming on the air recently with all my mates, and like they're all just reeling off fights. Of fucking hell, my handful looked at me and he's fucking had his fair share. He's like, "How many fights have you had, lad?" But I don't know more now that I box, to get to me. I don't have to, because obviously I get that side out of me. But you know, you still run into your knobheads, do you know what I mean? That are just, they're everywhere, aren't they?
Of course, people now put their place with time to time as well. But when you're a professional, when you've got a career, then you put everything else in the line, because you need to be squeaky clean. You need to learn how to take shit. You need to learn to not putting people in their place, even though you're raised in that way where, listen, let's go outside, and you know yourself, 99% of the people who you say let's go for a straightener, if not anybody here, they shite themselves.
Everybody talks a good game. Big fellas with all the muscles,
they're the worst,
mate.
Yeah.
They're the worst. I think they obviously do it because they're scared to have a fight, so they want to have this big exterior. Please, no one ask me for a fight, and it's all like a big blag. But
saying that, mate, I do know some fucking 7-8.
No, there will be. There is. Yeah, there's the monsters and the bigger the man. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
But some of them, it is a blag, because really, you know, they're afraid.
So you get done for the drug test, and then when did you get sent to the jail?
So I blame the FA for not giving me that rehab. They just get a straight ban, exile from football. You can't even train with a team till it's 3 months, the end of your ban. So I think I got a 14-month ban. So I'm fucked for 14 months, no income.
Did you have many sending offs?
In my career, John, what? I haven't had that many. I'm a big tough tackler, like, but I think I've had about three or four.
Do you think they had like a little bit of paper, maybe with your background check, fighting at the side of the parts and stuff like that?
No, I do believe that, you know, this person was trying to get this person out the club and he's rang them and said, look, because I think he thought he was the drug user and he weren't. He got it all wrong. So he's phoned them up and they've come and tested me. But Joe, what?
I don't know, mate. My instincts say you've been set up. Like, you weren't even supposed to be playing that game. Mm. And then you've got the phone call to be playing, and then you've been drug tested for the first time ever. Knowing
but that's sometimes out the stars weekend,
somebody's stuck in along the lines. When I was at Hibs, we used to sell things at half time called a Happy Hippie. They were called the totes. When we signed this one, we had to sell totes. But me and another boy used to steal the book, an extra book. So when we sold a tote, we used to give people a ticket for another tote, not one. So we used to make a few quid.
Yeah.
I'm 100% sure that prick stuck me in because there was a lot of jealousy there. And then
yeah, there is in
released me to Partick Thistle after that, and my career just kind of never went the same.
Possibly, but like when I look back now, I just think that, you know, it was all supposed to happen. Do you get what I mean? Yeah, obviously, course, to put me on this journey now that, you know, I don't know. But if I never got caught then, I would have got caught at some point because I would have kept using, I would have kept thinking I was okay, do you know what I mean, to drink ale and take drugs and play football. So I probably would have never reached the heights in football doing that, living that life, but I'd have probably kept keep doing it. I don't know, but you mature in age, don't you? Do you know what I mean?
I'd like to think so, mate. I pretend to be a professional in that shit, mate. But I'm still daft as fuck, mate. I still get crazy fucking thoughts. They never go. I just don't act on them as much.
Yeah. But you learn that with age, don't you? Do you know what I mean? You're impulsive when you're young.
So when you get sent to the jail, what's the story?
So, when I went to prison, I'd started boxing previously. I started having amateur fights at Barrow. We done a school fight, all the lads boxed each other at when we was about 21, all the lads from school, we all boxed each other to raise money for a teacher that was a boss teacher in our school. And my handful had come, all his mates are ex-boxers, he's ex-boxer, so they all watch me, but I boxed a proper boxer because I was sparring the lads from our school. As I say, I always looked after these lads, you know, I could weigh them in. So they said, nah, you'll have to box a proper boxer, you. So you'd had about 5 or 6 fights. So I ended up boxing him. He's well heavier, well bigger, and I'd done well with him. So my half fella turned around to me at the end of it, my Joe Watson, you've got ability there boxing. I know you've always asked me, fucking hell, I should have been boxing anyway because I was 21, I can do my own thing. He went, if you want to go and box and have a few fights, if it's still in you and you still want to do it, go and do it. So I went to the Salisbury ABC then, which is the likes of David Price, Derry Matthews.
Derry, shout out to Derry. He's another fucking crazy bastard. Yeah, he's a diamond.
So my first ever boxing show my dad took me to was to go and watch Derry when I was a kid.
Tough bastard, man.
Yeah, not half. Won a world title, won Commonwealth, do you know what I mean? Won a British. So there's loads. My amateur club's steeped in history, do you know what I mean? We're well known up and down fucking the UK. So I started there. My half fella phones his mate Paul Wright, who kind of took me under his wing. He was a coach there. And he says, Paul, this cunt wants to box. I've told him his whole life that, you know, he should be a footy player. Get him weighed in. Get your best lad. Fill him in. And we'll see how much he wants to box. So we do one night, we do 12 3-minute rounds. I hadn't had a fucking boxing fight at this point. I'm sparring a lad called Adam Farley. Ended up turning pro. He won the ABAs. He boxed for GB. He's fucking top lad my weight. He fucking punched me from pillar to post. He never fucking pulled no punches. So it comes home fucking like that. That's why my nose is like that. Thanks, Adam. And it comes in and I loved it. Even getting filled in, as you just said about then, it comes a point where you like it. And said to me, Dad, oh yeah, but I was all right. Some of the rounds, I was holding my own and that. So my half fella knew the boxing bug had got me then and I couldn't get away. Even at Accrington, scored that goal at Portsmouth. So that was on the Saturday. I boxed in the Merseyside and Cheshire final on the Wednesday against some lad from Hyerside, I think his name was Callum or something, knocks him out in the third round, but it was in the it was in Kirby where my two managers were from, and this fella comes up to me, fucking, he goes, all right, mate, he went, aren't you Paddy Lacey, did you score that goal on the weekend? I said, oh yeah, that's me. He said, what are you doing here? I said, lad, I'm the last one on, I'm fighting. He was like, are you fucking messing? You're supposed to be a pro footy player. So I couldn't shake it off, James. I couldn't not stop fighting. I couldn't stop the boxing. It had older. It had a grip on me. Where the football didn't have it. Yeah, it did because I missed it in jail. But yeah, the boxing had started and football ended at this point, so I was banned. And then I went to Denmark with Merseyside and Cheshire region, went and won over there, sits a lad on his ass. And then, yeah, because I digged my teeth in because depression was trying to get hold of me. I was ducking and diving away from my dad because I never told him at first I was banned. So I was hiding from him in the gym saying, oh, yeah, Dad, I'm going to training. Then for 3 weeks, he's checking. I said, oh, I'm not in the team. He's fucked me off again. And then he's looking, he's going, lad, you're not even in the squad. What's going on? Something's going on. I couldn't tell him because I said, Dad, I failed drugs test and banned for a couple of years. Fucking, it was his old world. He'd spent all the money taking me up and down motorways, do you know what I mean, James? Mm-hmm. And then one night after Liverpool derby, man, he scored me half, I was fucking buzzing. So I said, look, Dad, I've got some...
It's the right time when he's happy, mate.
Yeah, he was up there, so I just brought him level. So I just went, look, and I think he knew. As soon as he seen me face, he knew, Joe, it was something serious. And he said, lad, what? He said, I didn't know what was coming through your head. He said, I thought... Oh, it was going to be a fucking cancer shout. Oh, fucking. Do you get what I mean? Because I was like, Dad, look, I've got something to tell you. Shut the door. And he was half a bit relieved to think that it was. He never knew the seriousness of it, the severity, but he just looked at me and was like, all right, lad. And I went, Dad, I fucking ruined my career. It took me 22 years. I fucked it. And he was like, don't worry, son. Any times like that, my alpha has always been like, you can depend on him for shit like that. He knows, you know, if you're fucking about, you're fucking about, and he'll tell you, and he would give me a clip as a kid. But, you know, in times of need, he's probably the first person, even today, if, you know, I would go to my dad first. One time, just give you this little thing, I was working for him, and he was saying, son, you're gonna do this by yourself in a year. I'm going to teach you all the floor, and you save your wages, please. You know, you've got your footy wages, non-league, get yourself a van, and I'll get you the foot in the door with him. I'd like to shout them out, but they're a competitor now. This floor and third. No, my floor, oh, North Liverpool, they're another one. Fuck them. So, I'll get your foot in the door and you're earning your own money. You don't want to be working for me. You're all like, so anyway, I saves all this money. It's mad. Saves all this money. And one day I was just going to the bookies, James, and I think I had about $4,000 and I ironed $3,000 of it on them fucking machines.
Brilliant.
Yeah, well, all of it, I think. I don't think I had much left. I had about 5 ton. And James, I comes out the bookies. I'm not lying to you, I swear. I comes out the bookies, goes home, sits on the couch. And Joe, when you've probably had it with the gamble, everything's just a blur. You're watching the telly, but your mind's just... My half-father looks, turns to me on the couch and goes, all right, son, I've just spoke to the boss there at this flooring company. You're starting Monday. We're going to go and get your van tonight. Or say that was Saturday. We're going to go and get your van tomorrow. So I'm just like, I'm fucking done. I haven't got a penny left out of my savings that I'd saved for this man. So I went, Dad, I went, I fucking ironed all that money in the book. You dickhead, you fucking idiot. And he weighed on for me van and that. Then I still had that van, Joe, when I got banned from football. And I remember getting the train home from Wembley thinking, thank fucking ever sold that van. Do you know what I mean? So I had a way and a means to fucking earn money.
How much were you getting at Accrington?
So I was only on like 750 quid and you got paid for your games. But like my bonuses were going up every game. Every 5 games, my wages were going up. So I was on shit wages. I was actually on more money when I was at Barrow because they had a lot of dough at the time. So I took a bit of a pay cut to go a league higher. But it was like incentive based that come the end of the season, if you've played 30 games, you're going to be on a fucking good whack, including your appearance fees.
Bonuses,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Bonuses were only 22. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Then fucking, I've went to Glastonbury. I won a boxing tournament called the Haringey Open Box Cup. So it was the biggest open tournament in Europe. And I wins that, boxed the Swedish kid, the traveller kid. And I fucking comes home and my half-fella's sister died when I was in the semi-finals. So he comes home and he's devastated. And he must have bumped into me, mate, to somewhere, and he was all going to Glastonbury. He's never given me a pass. He's anti-fucking... He doesn't mind me having a drink with him in the house, but he's anti-fucking drugs and that. But he went mad how he said it. He was like, son, all your mates going to Glastonbury there. Are you going? I went, nah, I'm got a ticket on that. He went, you fucking go. You just won a gold medal in a big, massive tournament you've been training for 4 months for. Fucking go and enjoy yourself, lad. Fucking is what it is. So goes down to Glastonbury, gets nicked. And then fucking hell, from the space of playing in the Football League on Sky against Burnley and doing dead well and scoring goal of the month on Sky, fucking hell, how long ago? I'm fucking banned from football, career over, and I'm fucking in prison. What, 6 months was it or something? Yeah, 6 months. I'm fucking I'm going into Bristol jail, do you know what I mean? And just fucking, do you know what? When the judge was a fucking all nonsense, I mean, he was all about cunty proper, give it to me. And after I said a bit of shit that, you know, you're talented, you can box you, because I had all, you know, people that wrote and said this, and you keep fucking up, so you're going to a custodial fucking sentence today. I turned up to jail with nothing, because when I went for my pre-sentence support the week before, fucking the fella sat down with, he was like, you know, you've worked your whole life, you're a talented football, now you're a talented boxer, so you've got all these people saying, what's the point in sending you to prison, which is right, innit? You know, everyone deserves a chance. Defo never got a chance off the FA, they just hit me with the ban, the cunts. And then the fucking judge just gave me a custodial sentence, so I just rocked up in my suit, didn't tell me dad, didn't tell me mum, just because they had to bury the sister, do you get what I mean? So I phoned my dad from jail, so I got banned, and then I'm just like, hello dad, what's happening? Fucking
again. He's waited till Liverpool.
My mate was in the house though at the time, so my mate had phoned the courts, and then he'd went. So then my dad was like, I know what's happened. You fucking donuts. Fucking. You can hear me man screaming me, and I'm just like, thank fuck, I'm in jail, not in that house, because they'd be giving me down the banks. So prison, I was quite motivated. Funny, when I went into prison, James, fucking hell. Turns up with nothing, didn't have not a stitch of clothes on what I was in. So I'm in the holding cell. So all these half fellas waiting to go in. But luckily, I was in a lad who'd been nicked on the same day, because they were looking for all scousers, I swear to God, at Glastonbury. When you got nicked at Glastonbury, they were looking for them black notes, because they must have been within circulations or within scousers. Fucking shock. So when they took you to, I think it was some fucking, some custody fucking jail, I mean, police station. Lad, the queue was down the street with scousers. They'd nicked that many, so you walked in, it was chaotic, just scousers. So then they booked you in, done your interview, fucked you off. They fucked me off because they said, look, you go to the magistrate's court in the morning, but you've got money there, go and stay in an hotel then, make sure you go to the magistrate. So I went to magistrate in the morning, and they said, look, you no good here, Crown Court in 3 weeks, I think it was. So I just went back to fucking Glastonbury then. I thought, fuck, you know.
Okay.
We've come this far, I'm not going home to fucking feel sorry for myself. So I went back to Glasgow, then it was looming, it was hanging over me for 3 weeks. I was thinking, I'm going to fucking jail here. And when I went to prison, this fella, I've told him, I said, I haven't got a stitch of clothing on me. He went, son, you don't have a clue, you. He went, well, when you get in there, he said, when this woman books you in, gives you prison number, tell her you smoke 40 a day, because they've stopped smoking in jails now. Get yourself some of them fucking, I've never smoked, not a cigarette in my whole life. Get yourself some of them fucking
Nicotine patches,
he went, because you'll be able to swap them for shower gels, biscuits, currency in there. So I'm like, oh, it's right, mate, nice one. So I sit down with this woman, and she was just down at this prison fucking guard, whatever you called him, Skinner. So she was like, oh, like, do you smoke? Because you're ticking off. I went, yeah, love, 40 a day, because that got me the top band. So she looks at me like that, football, and she's like, oh, do you, yeah? She's like, all right. So then she gets you a little pass, and she went, don't you want to put one of them things on now? I went, I've never put one of them on before, love. I said, how to do? She went, yeah, just stick it off and put it on your arm. So it does it. Sitting, she's talking away. Fucking hell, the room spun.
No way. I started
sweating because I've never had nicotine in my system. I was like, fuck me. So then she's talking, I'm not even listening. I'm like, all right, love. Bangs back into this door, this old room. I said, mate, what the fuck's that? Shows you nicotine, do you mean? Mm-hmm. And then he's like, give me that fucking whacking on his arm. That's fucking mad. So then I had to, like, I could swap a few things out for shower gels, biscuits then, and prison was all right. I didn't really like Bristol because I wanted to get home. No one could come and see me. I was 3 hours away, 3.5 hours. So I was asking them every day on the bus. I was like, get me to Liverpool, mate. Get me to fucking Walton. Get me to fucking Strange Ways anyway. And then he come one day and went, look, I can get you to Risley. I think it was a category B. Or something like that. So,
what category were you?
I would have been a C or something, But I was asking, I was saying to him,
what did you get caught with?
Caught with £260 of 13 forged notes, and he had ecstasy tablets, and he had Charlie on me. So, you know, you're at Glastonbury.
The notes itself, like, that's not enough, because it's.
I got 14 months for them. I got 2 months for the ecstasy tablets and 2 months for the Charlie.
Defrauding the Bank of England. Yeah.
So, no one knows the severity of it, but I remember the busy. He had me at the time, and I'm just like, fucking hell, mate. And he said, have you got them notes? I went, nah. I said, I haven't got none of them. So he checks like a load of dough, and then he checks and goes, mate, you'll have, you know. So I've been like, oh, all right, fucking hell, I don't know. Someone's given me them, haven't he? So he scans, he's like, like, you've got 13 of them. I was like, because he was saying to me, these drugs are just going in the bin. And like, if you haven't got them notes, you know, you're just walking off.
Is this a screw? Or was that a security guard?
No, that's it. Busy's at Glastonbury this.
So they were happy just to take the drugs?
Say, you're at Glastonbury, everyone's there for the same reason, aren't they? Everyone's there to let their hair down. So when he found these, he was gutted for me. I was like, what's happening, mate? He said, I'm a footballer, you know, Joe, trying to get inside. He was like, mate, you're fucked. He went, this serious. And he said, where are you to find all you scousers with them? You've all got them. Some unbeknown, some no.
Could you not get on your toes, man?
No, because the way they done it, I'm just walking around. I've been out the night before. It was the first day of the music, so the night before was just a fireworks show. Been up all night talking shit, as you do at Glastonbury on Stone Circle. And I was just walking around, just got a breakfast, just had a towel, had my flip-flops on, just had a towel, and then I just got ushered. This fella, who was like just a security, went, no, you go that way. So I thought they were just sending us two different ways, you know, to your tents or something. So I've just walked down here and I've walked into a trap where there's fucking about seven busies. I went, what's happening? And then I realised, fucking hell, me man bag, I've got me drugs here. But they weren't even asked about them.
A special queue just for the scousers, mate.
So yeah, basically, I think that's what it was. You're just getting filtered through. If you've got a scouse voice, you're going that way. Wankers.
And you get 14 months for that?
14 months with the note, 2 months with the Charlie, 2 months with the ecstasy. So, like, fuck me.
What are you thinking the first night in your cell? Football career ruined.
Angry.
Boxing career. You're in the jail now. You can't run your business. Then does that make you question? How old are you?
23.
So still young, still only a kid, up, man.
But I was quite naive, to get what I mean, because I've been so focused on this football world, you know, through all that adversity and running a business and anything you do in life. Like, what I found is when you're staying in the same realms of working hard all week, going out, taking drugs, you stay within them walls, do you get what I mean? You can find, and you don't grow up and you don't learn things, so you're doing the same shit week in, week out. But when I went to prison and run the business and all stuff like that, fucking hell, I've grew tenfold, do you get what I mean? So these little things of failing the drugs test, fucking, so it hasn't half helped me in the long run. So I don't even look back angry. I've got no anger towards anyone that put me in this path. If someone did phone them drug testers, fucking made up, because I'm so much happier now out of football. Well, not out of football, still play for Chester. So much happier now of my life than I was fucking then, let me tell you.
Yeah, because you have still done everything that's got you into trouble.
Yeah.
It's just certain things in life happen where you end up getting caught. You just, I think with your honesty, I think you're probably telling people you're out drinking or telling people you've got fake notes. Or maybe it's just with your honesty, people, there's always fucking weirdos listening. There's always weirdos jealous. There's always weirdos who fucking stick you in. That's just the way it is life. Yeah. Like, the Scousers are kind of forward that way. Same as the Glaswegians, like we're kind of opening up front there. A lot of people get fucking thrown under the bus. Yes, you've been thrown under the bus probably, but you have still caused everything in your life that you've done as well.
Yeah.
And that's it's a bitter pill to swallow, that, to admit, do you know what? When you actually, you're dubbed up and you think, fuck me, like, how did I get here? But you got yourself there. And,
definitely.
Do you know what I mean? You know that yourself. How did you do your sentence?
So when I first went in, I knew that, you know, I can fight and I'm safe. Do you know what I mean? That, you know, if anyone, you're going into the unknown, you don't have a clue if there's fucking going to be murder in there. You're going to be sound. Straight away, they were saying to me, as you get booked in, don't tell no one you're a footy player because everyone's going to fucking be on you for dough. And that was like, mate, I was just earning fucking £750 a week. I've got no dough, do you know what I mean? So, I remember the first day I'm sitting, I was on the top fucking landing and I'm looking down the net with my mate Joe Cavi. He got nicked for the exact same thing, was in prison for the exact same thing. He got a lesser sentence than me. And we're on this. And as everyone's leaning over looking, some kid's hot sugar water has just melted this kid's face. And the kid was the wrong kid. He owed a debt, as it worked out. He owed a debt. This was the first day. So I was thinking, fucking hell, it's going off in here. It just melted his face. And then he's walked back over to him like, is that all right? Do we not owe money no more? And they went, that's the wrong kid. And this kid is next door but wants a job. Just going, obviously his face melting with those boiling sugar water. So then I've come back to the pad that day thinking, fucking hell. So make sure you're on your toes here. But it was sound. No, all lads down there were sound. And then finally got to Risley then. Risley was sound, but there's a crazy story in this, James. Crazy, which I still find crazy. Now, you're big for energy and picking up on things and all stuff like that. So everything in jail was fine. I had one little running. I had a scrape with this fella that no one liked, but I could fight. Knocks him clean out, fucking, in front of the prison. So all the lads knew, do you know what I mean? Oh, he's Andy, this kid. But then, fucking, one day, I've went for a visit. this is still mad. It's fucking, I find this crazy. So I went for a visit, and you go from wing to wing, obviously, as you know, they pick up all the lads and then they take you to the visit. So I'm standing here, and my half fella's mate, he weren't a proper mate, but he was, Bernie Flynn, his name was, he's a fucking diamond of a fella, but he'd done loads of jail and he'd done loads of bad stuff. So something about the last 24 years, he'd done 20 years behind the door for different things, and it was always to do with fucking violence, you know what I mean? But he was a nutter, but he was a boss fella with a big, big heart. And like, whenever he'd get done on these big charges, he'd say, you know, he'd never plead insanity or the red mist come over, he'd say, I know exactly what I've done, and I've done it for this reason, do you get what I mean? But he was a lovely, lovely fella. And my dad and some of his mates had boxed with his older brother, and that was his world, do you know what I mean, his older brother, and he lost him in a car crash. So when I've come to prison, I'm speaking to him, all right, lad, where are you from? This is at Risley. Yeah, Paddy Lacey. He went, did your dad, Joe, used to do security, doorman? I'm like, oh yeah. He's like, I know your dad, and that's his mate. Then I spoke to my dad, he went, fucking hell, how was he? He said, the last time I seen him, I wouldn't let him into one of the gaffs because he had a big knife on him. So I got there pally with this fella, and I was training him, and he was loving it, he was fucking boss. So we're going on, he had a visit this day, and as we're sitting here waiting to go in, this fella's talking, big fucking fat twat, just big massive. So I'm looking at him, and then he starts like trying to tell the lads what to do. Hey, get in line here because we want to process this quicker because we want to get on our visits. But straight away, James, in my stomach was fucking turning. I couldn't stand him, and I wanted. So I said something to him like, fucking shut your mouth, you little grass. Why are you telling everyone what to do? Shut your mouth. So he just like looked at me like that. And then it goes on my visit, all good. Must have seen a couple of the boys or something. Next day's library tip. You get to go and pick your books. So then all the books are on there, they're all fucking our ones. And then there was one book, Joey Barton's book. He'd been to jail just probably a couple of years previous. And he's from the same estate, all my family are off in Eton. I know Joey a little bit, met him golf a couple of times. So he picks up this book, and I hadn't really thought about this. I remember it vividly from when I was a kid. But on page 12, it mentioned where he was from. And, you know, he stands out. One of the two fellas got murdered off his estate when he was a kid, my uncle. So I hadn't really thought, Francis Perry and Paul Lagan. And the person that killed him was Sean Jackman. I always remember the name as a kid. I must have been 8 years old. And one of them was called Esposito because it was a foreign name, do you know what I mean? Three got nicked in it, one got off, and two got lifed off. And one was Esposito, and then one name I fucking never remember because it was and it said it on that, Sean Jackman. The metal baseball bat the fella and pissed on them when they were dead. So I had this name then, so I was sad and pretty. So I read this book, I'm like, fuck me. So then it comes out to Bernie the next day on the yard, and I go, all right, Ben. I said, you've never come across a Sean Jackman in jail, have you? He went, lad, do you know that fella you hated and you told him when you were going to, that's him. I went, lad, he's murdered my uncle. So like, fucking, how mad is that, do you know what I mean? I would have never got the name if I never read the book, and I would have never been just a crazy, like,
Connection.
But he was on, like, this special wing where he was all, like, I think he must be Cat A, mustn't he, because he's on a double murder. And he got really looked after. So when I've told Bernie, I've told the lads, all the lads are like, who had iPhones, I've went and checked him, like, he's a piece of shit, him. And obviously I'm with all the lads, so he somehow got word of it, I don't know, but he was always ducking and diving. He knew that, you know, he got me blocked off. I could never go on a visit with him. People were fucking doing things to him, and he was getting a few near scrapes, and it all turned in the jail. So he was swanning around thinking he was, you know, big fella. He was big, one of them donuts we talk about with all the water and the muscles. And then he went from fucking being up there to down there, and everyone's screaming, you fucking big dickhead. And there was people on his wing that we would meet them either, you know, they'd bring things onto our wing. They were like, fucking bring the books round, or they worked where you had your visits. And I was like, tell him that he's got, because he could use our yard, that he better get on this yard and he better fucking sort it like a proper man should with them. He only done it because he was steroided up and coked up. The fella was scared of anything, do you know what I mean? And he wouldn't, he was terrified. So everyone was like, lad, he's about 11 stone, the kid, well, a box 11 stone, weighs about 12 stone, he's about 20 odd stone, go and fucking get him in the yard. Terrified. So everyone was just, but like, I had to tell my ma and that, do you know what I mean? That he's in here, my ma's fucking heads up the wall. So, but it was lucky, James, because
your mum's brother?
My mum's older brother. I can remember, James, I can remember them getting the call. I can remember them, my dad fucking telling my mum, I can remember my mum punching the wall, screaming, this scream, and I open my door and she's punching the wall, just breaking her hands. Both her hands are broke off it, screaming, because, you know.
Yeah, it's mad. My mum's lost two brothers to murder.
How bad's that, though, James? Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's...
Always lives with you.
Deeply affected my mum to this day, do you know what I mean? Deeply affected. So, like, that is the only probably trauma I had in mind, watching my mum like that. And it happened for a couple of years. She was really in a dark place because she never lost him. He got took.
Yeah.
Do you get what I mean? Yeah. So, my mum lost her sister just previously before I went to prison. So, I was actively, I was trying to get my hands on this fella because I wanted to, really hurt him.
Bit of revenge.
A bit of revenge, as anyone would in this world. And he was going back and he was telling the screws, this fella said this to me, this has said this, and he was telling them. So they were coming to me in my pad going, look, he's saying, I was like, I don't know that fella from Adam. I don't know what you're on about. I'm just a footy player in jail, do you know what I mean? I just want to go home. And they were like, fuck it. I said, I think he's not on the bend. And they were believing me for a period. And then it come out in the wash. They must have found out that fella was obviously someone he murdered. It was my uncle. But I do believe that my auntie kept me from him in prison because there was a few near scrapes where we nearly got close. And Joe, he would have definitely, pressed charges and stuff like that. And I'd have done a lot more jail. And then that footy in the boxing would have been over. So... always know my mum saying, don't even bother, he's already ruined. Fucking hell. He, not just the murder, their kids, my cousin's fucking...
dad?
Yeah, my cousin's dad, he's a schizophrenic now, been shot, had loads of murder, that's all ties in with that, so there's a lot of fucking...
It's a ripple effect.
The ripple effect, that's what I'm looking for, James, you get what I mean? So there's a lot of fucking thing goes on with that, so luckily... That was that. Never got my hands on him. Thank fuck, I've been able to come out and pick the pieces up. Yeah. But I do think that was a dead close shave.
Because if you put it on him, there's a chance you might not have stopped.
Exactly, and I've never done that in my life. Anyone I've sat down,
and then you're no different.
Exactly, and then I'm stuck in there, and that's what my mum and dad were saying to me in there. But you're kind of consumed by it because that's all I could think about for 24 hours a day that he was in within close vicinity, and like if I get my hands on him, he's getting it. But I weren't supposed to get my hands on him, that's the truth, because I was supposed to come out and make something of my life, do you get what I mean? And which I'm on the way, I'm no one as it stands, but, I've worked my hardest since I come out.
Yeah, I wouldn't say you're no one, like, you're very well respected, everybody kind of knows you, you're clearly wear your heart in your sleeve, but you are fucking crackers, mate. You can see boxing as the perfect fit for you.
Exactly.
To then battle your demons, feeling right, and like you say, you get that sense of, you don't need to prove yourself anymore because you're in every day sparring, you're scrapping, and it's like a frustration in every man. I believe every man should go and do some sort of combat sport because I believe it. Like when I used to train at the Grip House doing Muay Thai, I used to think everybody I hang around with, they're all big and they've done a bit of damage. But even when we're out, we're all loud and daft. When I started going to the Grip House, man, I used to look at these people and I used to think, look, how the fuck can these people fight? And then when you see them fight, they're stone cold killers. And then the way they present themselves from outside of the gym, you would not think nothing of it. And then I started to realise they've nothing to prove. Why? Because they can handle themselves. Yeah. So now I know the people who do act like that are just fucking muppets, the loud ones, the daft ones, try to use a gun or a knife. Like, it's just that, again, exactly, it's another mask, whether it's steroids or it's a mask to try and protect
But I see that now with like certain people, they're always... they put on this like front, or like they try and be angry or unapproachable, or try and intimidate, and you see all this palaver, and I just see it as weakness now as I'm growing up. I just think, you're scared, really. That's why you're carrying on like that. You're scared, or
that is a mask. When you're starting to get out of prison a couple of weeks before, what were you thinking? When you're thinking, okay, I'm going to knuckle down, change my life.
Well, they come to me a week before and they went, look, bang to rights, we know that everything you've told us is a lie. Do you know what I mean? With this fella, with all the carry-on, because they said they had a dossier. He reported every single bit of information.
So he was sticking you in?
So he was sticking me every little bit of information that he did. Someone said this, someone said that, this is going to happen. So he put all this in. So in the end, the fella, the screw come and went, like, we know it's your uncle now. So we understand that, you're not just bullying someone. You're going to get your tag, but if one of your mates, because there was all people do madness to him, because everyone liked me, I was a nice kid. They went, but if any of your mates do anything to him or say anything to him, it's getting took off you, because they're getting for a cat eye, was he? They get like $150,000, just say, a year to look after him. To look after me, who would say a cat C, a cat C I was.
Yeah,
40 grand. 40 grand, you get what I mean? So who's getting sent down the road? You, because he's getting what I mean. So he just, the fellow who'd sorted the tag discreet was like, look, son, you know, you can go and make something of yourself. And basically the chat what we just had, if you get your hands on your item or whatever or something, you're just going to get your tag took off. You don't have to do another 4.5 months jail and you're going down to Bristol. So in the end, they got out and then I thought, right, I'm fucking picking up the pieces. Everyone in jail was like, lad, what are you doing in here? You're a good footy player, you're a good boxer, you got a career, come on. Everyone was willing for me to do well. When I was in prison, my old team, they won the league, Accrington. That was all my teammates. So every week, I'm clicking on the scores, one again. So when I come out, they was top of the league and I was going in, thought I'm straight into training, the top of the league, they're going to win the league. I come out and I phone me mate who was with me at Glastonbury, Dean, and he always said, like, whilst your band, keep playing Sunday League. Just, I know it's no standard, but, you know, keep yourself fit. I was doing my boxing, but keep your eye in football. And I went, lad, I'm never playing Sunday League. But I come out and thought, you know, I could do with the game because I had no gym at all in prison.
Why? No gym?
This prison was back to front. They were understaffed, so it was 23-hour bang up.
Oh,
so what I mean? And I think the only thing I got to do was badminton once a week.
That's a tough sentence.
Do you get what I mean? No, but I was only behind the door for 5 months, James.
Yeah, but it's so tough. Even still, mate. I only done that for 3 months.
Yeah.
I was in every fucking hole in Ballinney. Every fucking hole. I was in A hole, E hole as well. That's where the beasts are. But you're there for one night when you just go to the prison, just like an overnight thing. Get sent to A hole, get papped off out of A hole for fighting.
Mm-hmm.
Get sent to B hole, and that was a 23-hour double. I was only there for 2 days and I fucking hated it. I asked for a request. They gave us a job in the gym.
Yeah,
I tried to get gear slung over the wall. I told my pal to cancel the tickets. I used to see the films and you think nobody listens to the calls.
Mm.
Says, look, cancel those tickets. The gardener's not, says, well, something not making today. And I didn't know, tanned the cell and get put back into B hole.
Mm-hmm.
And it was fucking painful.
Yeah,
it was horrible. It was 23 hour dub up. It was fucking brutal. And
that was the norm for us, though, Joe.
No, that was horrible, man.
Bristol was sound. I was on gym straight away. The screw's like, lad, you want to get in that gym? Go to that. So I was getting like 3 gyms a week. I remember speaking to my dad. I went, dad, it's sound. You know, I think I was boxing up candles. You know, they give you shitty jobs, don't they? And I was in the gym 3 times a week. And I spoke to my dad and was like, dad, it's sound here. Don't worry about me. Just trying to be positive. And he went, fucking hell, it sounds like you love it there. You don't want to make this a life choice, do you?
Yeah.
I was like, no, dad, it is what it is. So I comes out on the Thursday, I think, and then Friday. And then I had this game with my mate. I phoned him and, you know, you said, get back playing footy for you. I said, I'll play this weekend. So I'm out trying to pick up the pieces, dead motivated. Couldn't wait to get going, just knew I could play football, I'm going to be in a football league, let's have it, because I wrote to the manager saying, oh, I'm sorry about this, I looked after, and they said, come on, as soon as you get out, get training with us. So it comes out, playing against Liam Smith, boxer, beefy.
Yeah.
So we're Sunday league team, and I just done, 10 minutes into the game, just turned, my knee just went, snapped me cruciate, as I fell over, dislocated and broke my arm, been out of jail 48 hours. So, like, I'm trying to fucking make things right here, and I'm standing there in the pissing, well, laying down with the pissing down rain with a broken arm snapped, knee snapped. So that fucked me up. I went and got an operation on that, so that held up the football. But, you know, I was always trying to train, get, like, thingy and that. I put it up the other day about Tyson Fury, didn't
I? Seen it, mate.
That's where I met Tyson Fury, do you know what I mean? And I had the little thing with him and that.
So was that a turning point, meeting him?
I wouldn't say it was a turning point because I was in the gym, so you know I was doing something, James. I was actively doing something, but it made he never turned around to me like, son, you can do this. He never done that. He was a larger than life character. As I've turned up to the gym, just a big monster. He was in an Al Jag, this proper Al Jag. Fuck, oh my God, to be made this Tyson Fury. So it jumps out. I had that little bit of rapport with the gym. He trained in a gym. Franny Hans, that was his dad's coach as a pro. And his first ever spar, he sparred Franny's son, Anthony Hans, who was a boss footballer, played with my cousin at Everton and his best mate. And Anthony, believe it or not, put him down with a body shot. He was being sick. So Anthony's got the story of when you see Tyson Fury saying, you know, he's the hardest man in the world. I've put him down with a body shot, which is nice. So, he just told his story and we're reeling each other off. You know, like we've been through the same things that you have to speak to them. You have to go through that and the ban. And he was 27 stone. He was ginormous, and he he just had so much life in him, had everyone laughing, and he's in Liverpool, and people were saying, didn't you get beat by David Price? So I was an amateur, and he's like, I'm going to go and see David Price straight after this, which he did. He phoned him, got his number off someone in the gym, and when I met him, I had a coffee, and he put it up on their Instagram. But he was just larger than life, and he had everyone laughing, and he just said, look at me, lad, I'm 27 stone. And he said, I'm going to lose all this weight. First, I'm going to knock out Deontay Wilder. I'll knock out Tyson Fury. He said, I'm knocking them all out. They're all shit. So I'm just like, you're sick. So when I've walked out the gym thinking, you know, dodgy knee, dodgy arm, he is fucking, I think he must have been close to death because he didn't look healthy, do you know what I mean? But he was on his way, so they felt minuscule then.
He was still world champion when he kind of went off the rails. Yeah. Like, he's never stopped being world champion. Obviously, he went up to...
He's the lineage, Ginny, that's what he says. Yeah, so
One of the greatest heavyweights of all time, man. And I think when he beats Joshua, I don't know if that's a tough fight, but if he beats Usyk that now, he'll be up there as top three, I believe, best heavyweights of all time, especially from what he's come back with. And the way he talks, the way he presents himself, crazy family.
Swear to God.
It's unbelievable.
He just had this room, they're all like 20, 30 fellas in the changing room. Do you know what's funny? And I don't really want to say, but this is just how mad he is. So we're talking, and there's like these 20, 30 fellas listening to his story, and he just turned around, bet you think I've got a big cock, don't you? Wrong, and just pulled his tackle. Everyone's just like, what is up with you? And he went, Frank Warren's going to pay for the dick enlargement. Everyone was just crying, and I come home to my uncle. I went, Dad, you know him? I said, you could drop him off anywhere in the world. I said, and he would just get people on his side because he's just a lovely fella, do you know what I mean? Funny. Fucking. So, I got an operation then, James, on my knee. Got sepsis. Was in hospital for weeks. Lost 3 stone. So I come out trying to pick up the pieces, but everything I'd done was just getting worse. Snapped my cruciate, which is obviously a career end of football. Dislocating broke my arm. Fucking got an operation, got sepsis, lost 3 stone. Fucking end up snapping my other cruciate, broke my cheekbone. Anything I tried, just things weren't happening. Then it seems like the last year or so that, you know, it started to turn now. Yeah. Do you get what I mean? That, you know, I've got a bit of luck now, and I'm running with it. Probably loads of hard work as well. Do you get what I mean? I've put loads of hard work in. Regardless of injuries, I've stayed in the gym, done what I could. If one leg's broke, use the other leg. If one arm, use the other. So I've worked tremendously hard, and I've had a fair bit of luck. You've seen, what's her name, Molly May, come out this week, just work as hard in 24 hours. Mm-hmm. You know, you do need luck. I don't care what anyone says, do you know what I mean? She got a bit of a touch getting on Love Island.
Made that luck as well to do
Default.
She has got so much stick for that.
Like, yeah, this week.
Understand.
But you need a little bit as well, don't you?
Understand what she's trying to say. Everybody has got the same 24 hours in a day.
She's 22, do you know what I mean?
Some people get more lifted up, but I know people that's had millions and had all the opportunities in life and lost that.
Yeah.
I also know homeless men that have changed their life and become multi-millionaires.
Yeah, definitely.
So I get what she's saying. Everybody does have the same 24 hours in a day. People are giving her shit. I get it. She went on Love Island, but she's still got to put herself in the limelight. Mm. Plus, she's still got to go through all the shit that she's receiving online, the hate.
Definitely.
Still got to go all the modelling shoots. And listen, yes, people might think that ain't an easy life as well. Mm. From the outside, people might think it is, but the shit that she will get, and she did get a lot of shit for that.
It was just the way she presented it, but the way she said it, do you get what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
The court on this, there's probably loads of shit now. I probably won't watch it back because I cringe, but I go, oh my God, why'd you say that, do you get what I mean? But it's hard, isn't it?
Yeah, it's life, man. But so when you started becoming injury free, when you started going through the ranks, just promoting your sponsor there, bro.
Wow, hydrate there. Look,
it's a flying, flying bastard, mate. Typical Scouser.
Going to come with all my jumpers for work and all that. Look, we will go anywhere for Graf, North Liverpool Club.
I know Jamie Reid, who's involved in that as well. Great guy, man. That is actually great. They send me boxes all the time, we'll promote them, mate. Mm-hmm. I literally hydrate. Wow, hydrate. Getting that open, flying bastard. When you started getting fit, started to feeling the tide was turning. Did you stop drinking and taking gear as well, though?
Oh, yeah, totally. So what turned around for me was that little time in prison, 23-hour bang-up, it forces, like, realisation on yourself. I was in a single pad, still training like a nutter every day as I could, but, like, I was kind of just thinking every day, how the fuck? Do you know, I was playing my team at top of the league. How have I ended up here? Do you know what I mean? I never felt like I deserved to be there. I felt like a couple of people, you know, the FA, the judge could have looked more, you know, fondly on me. They were quite stern with what they give me. But I was reading good books and kind of just looking inward, which I do now I'm changing, James. It's scary how fucking I look back and people trying to meet me now, they don't really know me anymore. And they're like, lad, the way you think and how you carry yourself, how you are, you're miles away from what probably I was when I was 22, 23. But I think that doesn't stop, do you get what I mean? You're always, well, I am now, analysing myself and just trying to get better all the time. And it started in jail and I dissected where I went wrong and where I was doing. And, you know, if you keep hanging around with people, they're still my mates. My mates still my mates since I was a kid. But I don't go and have 10 pints of them anymore. I don't drink hardly anymore. Do you get what I mean? Because, you know, you keep going to barbers, you get your hair cut. So I just kind of give them a wide berth. I met a fantastic girl as soon as I come out. My bear doing with now, love. So I knew her when we was kids. She was best mate with my cousin. And then when I went to prison, a lad lived on her estate. I went, lad, do you think of it? He went, lad, she's always had a boyfriend there. He said, if she's been single now, shit, she'll have a boyfriend. You've missed the boat. And I was like, fuck, shit. And I was going to ask him, I was going to say, lad, what's her address? Because I'll write to her. But I thought the lads all just came me on the wing, so I never said nothing. Comes out, straight on her. Oh, yeah, fucking hell, I can't believe he gave you prison. I've been waiting. Sound. So I met a boss girl then, James, and I always think, yo, this. So Brian Clough, the great manager, obviously, he used to try and get his players married early on, because what it brings, what comes with it, you know, you've got a bird, there's someone to answer to, and they bring out a different side, which most definitely has, do you get what I mean? And she's been a fucking saving grace for me, really. She's been fantastic. As much as I've matured myself, some of it's been forced upon me, because like, she's very mature, me bird. She, although we're the same age, she's clued up, she's so successful, James. She does dead well with her own nails, she's so driven. So,
do you want to promote the business, bro?
Oh, yeah, she's just got a shop, Woo Nails. She is by Sarah on Instagram. She's got like 50,000 followers. She does dead well, but she's opened her own salon. So, she
may
will.
May as well promote it, mate. You promote it.
Everything else.
I thought you were coming in here to tell your story, mate. I'm just coming here to promote everybody's business.
So, she will be successful. She's that driven. She's obsessed. That's all we talk about in her business. So
do you think that's been a big part of having another 50% come in, where
therefore
you've decided to focus? You don't want to lose her. So if somebody's successful and somebody doesn't take any shit, you know, if you step out the line, you're done.
You're done, and you need it. Do you get what I mean? Yeah. A few of my mates recently, they've been, the birds have been younger, and my mates phone me like, lad, I think I need a bird a bit more mature, you know, because she's got you into shape, do you know what I mean? So, yeah, I'm lucky in that sense, and I've really grew up. And the way I just think about everything now, I was impressed by knobheads, James, when I was young.
Same, bro.
You know, as you grow up, and then like you look back where we're at now, and you think, fucking hell.
How gullible you are, innit?
I was impressed by absolute tools, do you know what I mean?
So when was your first pro fight?
So my first pro fight was October this year.
Last year?
Last year, for hell, yeah.
And so, how was that then? Everything that you've been through, from football career, injuries, prison, drug tests, to then turning pro, and was there any nerves before it? Were you thinking anything was going to go wrong? Injuries or jail or anything daft?
There's a little bit of butterflies in there, but I'd had about 19, I think. No, I'd had 17 amateur fights, so I've been through it. Having a fight on the street is exactly the same as having a fight in a thing. You get them little bit of nerves, but it's going off. So you're fighting anyway, and it is what it is. But always knew I should have boxed as a kid, James. I always had this in me, Joe. If you're fighting with everyone all the time, try and use that energy that you're doing. And it was obviously something I wasn't scared to do. Have a fight with someone, Joe, go to a boxing gym. Any kids, my dad kept me away from it. So it happened late on in life. So it was like, finally, I'm here. I'm a pro fighter. Well, I'm going to be. And I couldn't stop smiling, James. I swear to God, I walked out to the ring walk and just smiling at everyone. Finally, the face off where you're supposed to look mean with the fella, I can't stop smiling at him because I'm just made up. He even clocks me. The fella was massive. He was too big. I shouldn't have fought him, really. But he clocks me in the second round with two good punches, and you're there. The crowd go, ooh, like fucking hell, that's not part of this game. As I turn out, I'm just smiling still. I couldn't stop smiling all the way through it. It was unbelievable to finally do it. Sold a load of tickets. I've had loads of support, probably because of, you know, as you said, I don't pull no punches when I speak. I'm just, I am. If you don't like me, sad. But I sold a load of tickets to my second one, And then Eddie Hearn put a show on in Liverpool. He needed whoever sells the most tickets in Liverpool, who can we get on? And it was me. So I got on the Matchroom bill then, which is a bit weird from going from, you know, the Olympia in Liverpool, good venue. But then these ones in the Echo Arena where there's a press conference, where there's a... It's different stuff, mate, let me tell you.
What's the best feeling you've had, the Eddie Hearn event or scoring the Portsmouth game?
So I prefer...
Was your dad there at the boxing?
Fucking hell, yeah.
Was about fucking...
He's probably by the bar, though. He got the expensive tickets with free bar, but no, he was there. I've kind of... Joe, when I was knocking people out in the ring, me two little brothers boxed. That's probably the best feeling I've ever had, watching them box and win. I don't know why that is in close fights. That's the best feeling I've ever had. But when I was knocking loads of people out in the amateurs. Once I got sat on my ass first round and gets up and knocks the lad out in like 30 seconds. That's the best feeling I've ever had, that. And he's my mate now, Sean. He's sad. Get on with... Sorry I knocked you out, Sean, but I did.
No, you're not.
And then the Portsmouth goals are close second, but the last three fights, I've had a fantastic feeling, but not unlike them. But them feelings will come, so if you're fighting for a title and you KO someone, I just know the feeling's going to be better.
Yeah, it's fucking some career you've had. Like I say, you've got a book there, you've got a film, you've got so much. Therefore, how old are you now? 28?
28 now, yeah.
It's a great age. That's a mature age. Between, I always say this, but between the ages of 28 and 35 is real good ages where you want it, if you really want to make something of your life. Yeah. That's a real crucial age.
Well, I think
that
you peak a little bit later in the boxing as well.
30, isn't it? 31,
30, 32. 32, yeah. Do you know what I mean?
So where do you see yourself going with the boxing?
As high as possible, do you know what I mean? I'm aiming for world titles. Do you know, some lads, I find it mad that, you know, they turn over pro and then they get asked, oh, I'm just, you know, we'll just see where it leads and all that. Come on, we've all got to have aims and goals. And, you know, I want my first title next year in 2024. So I want another good year of learning, probably have five or six fights, maybe even at the end of this year, I don't know. But
who's the British title holder?
At the minute, Troy Williamson, a lad up in Durham. But, you know, I've done plenty of rounds with Beefy. Beefy is the, for me, so... I love all the Scouse boxers. I did watch, you know, old school boxers, but I always looked up to Tony, the Smith brothers, Derry Matthews, and Beefy, kind of the one that I always watched and thought, the way he fights is sick, to remain. So I've done loads of rounds with Beefy, and I can get to that standard one day. It's going to take me a lot of hard work, but that's the standard I'm trying to get to. Do you get to me? He's fought Canelo, world champion. I reckon he's going to win another world title. He's got a good fight against Jesse Vargas, but coming up, he'll
Vargas
do it again.
Is good, man.
Vargas is good, but Beefy's big and strong. Yeah. So,
why do you think Scousers are so good at fighting?
I just think you've got to fight in Liverpool. I grew up in one of the better areas, do you know what I mean? But I'm still fighting every day. If you're looking for a fight, when I put up that Matchroom thing, John Danny Vaughan, the coach.
Yeah, Danny.
So Danny's wrote to me saying, lad, I've been waiting for you to box your whole life, because his son Daniel, we was the same age.
I know Dom.
Yeah, and Dom, yeah. So we was all the same age, and I was fighting all the time. So we used to watch with my dad, him and my dad are mates, and go, he should box him. My dad wouldn't let me. He said, finally, you're fucking boxing, son. You've always been a boxer, not a footy player. So I don't think people are surprised if you, no one heard of me 20 years from school, eight, and you said, Paddy's a pro boxer. They'll be like, fucking sounds about right.
Because the dad retired, didn't he? The dad just retired there.
Oh, Georgie, yeah. Georgie. So Georgie trained my dad.
In his 80s, what was it, 86, 87?
Fucking hell. What a fella.
It was Jazz's fight, wasn't it? Jazz, I know, another fucking legend, another crack.
Jazz is a belter. Yeah.
But all the Scousers, man, like, after Scouser, like,
I think you're going to learn
Tony them, Bell, you fucking Paddy Baddy, Dan Till, like, they're all fruitcakes. All fucking diamonds, though. Oh, absolutely. You've got Molly, and you've got so many Scousers coming through, even the UFC. Like.
Not half, yeah.
So
Paddy's taking it by storm, isn't he?
Fucking love Paddy, man. Yeah, he's just a good guy. It's just in the camera, same as this interview as well. People will connect to it because they're thinking, wow, I'm blown away. A lot of people watch interviews as well and don't expect what they see and they go, fuck me, that was brilliant. Like, a lot of people take things out of everything that people say because you've clearly got it's an inspirational story.
Yeah.
It's just keeping your feet grounded and then going for that world title. Yeah. And then you've got, as I kind of told you, so it's a relief, but I don't think with your nature that's enough for you.
Yeah.
You just kind of want to conquer the world, innit?
It's just mad, you know, like loads of people message me now, you haven't half inspired me. Loads of people, well, especially going up to that fight week to remain when everyone's in tune with it. I'm like, I'm not qualified to tell anyone what to do, but this is my story. And I watch all your podcasts, so with all... mostly the fighting lads or whatever, and you relate to certain things and you listen to certain things, you go, fucking hell. Yeah. So I think we're all helping each other.
But you're doing something about it now, and that's a great thing to see. You're clearly a good guy, man, who wears his heart on his sleeve. You're a bit fucked up like the rest of everybody, mate. Especially all the scouts, mate. Down, yeah. There's definitely something in the water down here, man. You're thinking, how the fuck is so crazy? But yeah, all diamonds, 100%, all fucking there for you. Like I say, I've got so much respect for everybody that's been on this podcast, but the Scousers, there's always a connection there with that. They're just kind of fucked up, and it's a beautiful thing.
I see
thing
loads
to see.
Of me, Joe, when them lads are on and they listen to certain things, it's just like it's dead relatable to them, especially the Scouse lads, obviously.
But you're still young, and to go for a world title shot, man, is a beautiful thing, and I believe in you that you will. And
hard work's going to get me there. Plenty of hard work in between, but I love it.
How's your dad's nerves with you? Is he more content now with you, or is he still on edge? Getting those phone calls. Your dad knows everything that's wrong with you.
Yeah.
When you got drug tests to do new
he
stuff.
He can't believe
wrong.
Who I've turned into, to be honest.
He'll be proud of you. Did he say that?
No, plenty of times.
Oh, does he?
He watches just anything that's on me of YouTube. He just sits down and watches me. And I think, Dad, you've watched this 200 times, do you know what I mean? Football, boxing, whatever. But so he's got me two younger brothers who are promising young footballers, so...
But they'll look up to you then. Do you feel a bit of pressure on you from that as well?
It was lovely. I went to my ma's the other day, and my mum turned around and went, I wish Sarah and Paddy would hurry up and fucking have kids, do you know what I mean? I can't wait. And my little brother Shay, he's 15 at Man United, he turned around and went, I don't want them to. I need our Patrick right now to help me with my footy career. So I do, therefore, we're so close, me and my two little brothers. That's all we've ever heard. We are. James, I understand how, like, you know, where we're from, Liverpool, people didn't have much. They mightn't have much, but their kids are dressed from head to toe in designer, and they look at, because probably they never had it as a kid and they wanted it and they give it to their kids. So my little brothers have got me wrapped. If they need dough, if they need anything, I'll give them my last pound note, to them, because I just see myself in them. So I'm just, because I'm more in touch with what's going on. One's 17 today, Lewis, happy birthday, lad. And Shay's 15, no, turning 15. You know, I know what to look for when they're probably falling into the wrong crowd. They're not doing things right. So I like to think they do definitely listen. They do definitely listen to me.
Because your mum as well, that losing a brother to murder is hard as well. So if you're going into prison and getting done for drugs and losing your football career, then it's always going into the back of her mind that it potentially could happen to you in a night out. Because how many people, money wankers, carry blades, do you know what I mean?
So it makes you,
that's the thing as well, that when my mum was going through all her struggles, I was adding more misery to that, adding more misery towards the pain that she was already going through. But then when you change your life and start doing good, like, they start changing. The whole persona starts changing, man.
So I think my mum was thinking around that time when I was in prison, like, what has happened to your son? You were thinking you were going to sign for the Premier League team 6 months ago, and now you're saying, if I get my hands on this man, it was like a pure crossroads in life. And she was like begging me, don't, son, don't ruin your own fucking life. But it's mad, this life though, James, and energy and synchronicity, loads of different things. And I just think, when I was stood in that ring, I was supposed to be there at that right point in my life, do you get what I mean? It was all supposed to happen. Might not have supposed to happen that way if I'd have listened earlier when I was a kid.
Your life could have went another way though.
Could have, yeah. But if I'd have boxed earlier as a kid, I'd have been, you know, probably a little bit further ahead, do you get what I mean? But it's happened, and it's happened when it was supposed to happen. So
when's your next fight?
So my next fight's March the 5th, I'm open now. But I went into that last fight with a broken hand. I half knew, I boxed 2 weeks before, but I'd sold a load of tickets, fucking 40, 50 grand worth of tickets. Couldn't tell everyone I weren't boxing, so I didn't even get an X-ray. I just said, look, I'm not punching this right hand next 2 weeks till fight night. Lo and behold, put a picture up on that my hands were gone. But it was this hand that was broke, got them both X-rayed. So that's resting up, doing a bit of active recovery. But March the 5th, I'm hoping that I'm going to be back out soon.
And you're playing for Chester now?
Playing for Chester, so... The whole football out of me, James, when you want to be in the Premier League and it's your all and everything. So I've got a business, I've got me boxing, I enjoy football now. Cause
how the fuck do you juggle it all?
It's hard. That is the one thing. So
What would you do if you couldn't train? How will you when you don't exercise?
See, there's all videos of me when my knee snapped and my arms and I cast them. I'm just training one leg, and me make videos. And me said, that's not normal, you should be on the couch. But I've got to do something. You know, the way I see it is in the army, James, you know, there's lads, fucking brave men, over there, bullets whistling past their head, and they come back, and if they sat and they sat on that bed, thought, I've got a family at home, what do? They clean. They clean everything, it's spotless.
Keep busy.
Keep busy, you've got to keep busy. The more they sit and you be still, my mind will think over, and like, you probably make problems that aren't even real. So I love being busy.
What is the plan though, if once you start moving through the ranks and boxing, start making serious dough, then you're going to need to make a decision?
Of course, yeah. And boxing will always get the nod come over first. The football, because, you know, football, I'm not finished. I've had 7 knee ups, 2 in my ankle. It is what it is. I'm a good player at that level still, but as it stands, I'm in the 6th tier of English football. So there will be a point when that comes, but at that point, James, you know, you're probably fighting twice a year if you're lucky. So what am I going to do for the rest of them? So I can always play football, and when it comes, you know, a month before, fucking hell, Beefy plays fucking Sunday League the week before, 2 weeks before, and then fucking, he went and boxed in Russia, got a flight home, boxed, played the next day after having 12 rounds with the world. But he's different class, gear, him. He's different gear, so.
He's a great fighter, man.
Oh, he's fantastic. Great fighter. Fantastic. So,
so what happens when you're in fight camp? So you're fighting March, you just keep playing football?
I keep playing football, like the last ones. Like, I get paid decent, don't it? Pays all my wages, my bills, James, to get them in. So,
it's fuck all in boxing just now.
There's nothing, I'm not hearing nothing it costs me to get them in. I sell a load of tickets and I make a little bit of money, but you know.
But it only lasts, it's only one blast. It's
not
every week.
And then I'm not fighting out of box at the start of
October.
The last fight was the start of December. Now I'm not going to box till March. So, you know, you've got December, January, you don't earn nothing, so it's unfair for anyone that I find and kind of get spoke about. You know, he wants to pack that footy in. Well, not really, mate. You wouldn't ask no one else to pack in the day job after only having 3 fights. Do you get what I mean? Yeah. So,
have you signed to Matchroom?
No, I haven't signed. Hopefully, when I get to a point, if I keep selling tickets and I keep doing well, Joe, I'm going to force a big promoter's hand where, you know, he's doing loads. I'm earning the money at the end of the day. Do you know what I mean? With my ticket sales. So, I would have never, James, if it weren't for the boxing, I'd never have been on here. Because, you know, everyone wants to know your story. You need a storyline in boxing.
Yeah.
Unless you're a superstar out the amateurs that everyone knows anyway, that won a gold medal at Rio or whatever. So, people aren't interested, to get what I mean? So, my story's come out and everyone's fucking on me saying what a story that is. But it doesn't really sound that mad to me because obviously I've lived it, haven't I? I'm getting big following now with this show.
Yeah.
It'll force one of their hands to go, bloody hell, he's investable, he looks good, sells tickets, we can do something with him. So I think that'll come over the next 4 or 5 fights.
Yeah, it'll happen this year. It's an investment. People love those stories. You're not the only one. Look at the Tyson Fury story.
Yeah.
Look at that story. World champion and absolutely fucked it. People relate to him more. Why? Because the majority of people take gear, and it's 100% of the time. If you've not took gear, you know somebody that's took it.
Fucking right.
Or it's been in prison.
I had a job interview the other day on with the big organ. I won't even mention them because I mightn't get the job. But you know, and it was 4 people in a Zoom, and I was just getting grilled, James, about, you know, what I'd done. Like, making out I was pure scum of the earth, and I felt like saying,
fuck
you've
off.
Been to university, because she was a well-spoken man. You've been to uni, you've probably either seen it, done it yourself. Come on, don't like chastise me in front of all people. And luckily, you know, I can speak and talk to people. I was like, fucking hell, it was a bit harsh. You made me feel a cunt there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I've come, that was like 5 years ago. Yeah. But when it happened, fuck me.
But the fucking people look down at you will always do that. Listen, it'll happen in 5 years. You'll get 99% love, but people will still, if you win a world title, you'll get some arsehole will say, oh, but he was in prison, or he's done this, or do you know what I mean?
It was funny, one of the first videos I ever done when I signed with me promoter, Steve Wood, Steve's sad, it's like Steve, and he puts up like this little thing, so a little video where you get to meet Paddy Lacey, none of the stuff that we spoke about, just boxing stuff, and like a girl comments on it saying, well, at least we know who'll bring the drugs and the drugs and black notes to the aftermath. But you think, what possesses you? Why are you even asked? You know what I mean? But there is people like that, as you say, that are just.
We used to do the thing with fake scores as well. Like I used to give my friend one to dance, and he actually get to jail. It was a nightclub called Silver, back in Glasgow, mate. And I give him going up and get around. The Daft coming up and get around, mate, and he get nabbed, huckled down, mate, in the jail Thursday night. Never get out to the Monday, done for fraud. But it was only that. It was like four notes, 5 notes.
Yeah.
I thought maybe just take them off you, but clearly they fucking don't.
Fucking yeah. I wait. Well, if I knew that I had them, then you wouldn't put yourself in that situation. Funny, but obviously, when we've all been nicked, loads of people, and people have found out, there were scousers, let me tell you, digging holes in Glastonbury, burying these notes because they must have had them, do you know what I mean? Didn't want to get caught with them, but...
What do you think now, talking about your life? You're still young, man. You're still young. The whole world's
beat your
feet.
I'm full of fucking desire to succeed and do well, do you get what I mean? So, but I just know the way I live my life now, that, you know, regardless of nothing really happens in football, boxing, I'm happy and I've got a business that's growing and I'm in a fucking good place, mentally, physically. I feel fucking great, James, day to day. Do you know what I mean? I'm lucky.
Because there's so many people who have been in your position as well, that especially from Liverpool, that have had Billy Kenny on, played wherever, turned alcoholic at 19, Big Paul Kelly, UFC fighter, end up in the jail. Potential to be fucking...
Could have been a UFC star.
Exactly, man. Like, it's hard to see, but you have got not just one chance, you've had so many different chances. I believe because you've got a good energy that you're always going to present opportunities.
In school, it was like, how I made it out of school without getting throughout was a miracle, and all my mates say, oh, you should... Because, like... I was always just honest and sound and, you know...
The cheeky chappy, isn't it? The lovable that kind of thing.
And I think that's why I sell so many tickets as well, because people think he's all right then. Mm-hmm. Well, I like to think that. They might be buying him open to get knocked out.
But life is going good. You seem in a good place. Yeah. And your story is unbelievable. I thoroughly enjoyed it. It's great energy. That normally sometimes interviews can be draining because they're quite dark. A lot of my stuff is quite dark. Yeah. But even though there's a bit of darkness in there, it's still good.
There's a positive spin in the end,
there's always
isn't it?
Positive, and I look forward to seeing the rest of your journey. I believe you'll be world champion.
Thank you, James.
And your old boy, man, I'll no doubt keep
mate, he is a colourful character. Yeah. You need to get him on here, you know. Hello. He would fucking have everyone laughing.
So, your fight's in March, where is the fight?
It's in Liverpool Olympia. So back to the smaller hall shows till maybe a skyboxing match room. They put a show on in Liverpool and I'll be able to jump on that.
And you want to promote anything else before you're finished? Give anybody a shout out?
No. That is basically my story. And like, if anyone is in them situations, the main thing for me is today's news is tomorrow's fish and chip paper. You think at that time when you're going through these things, which I was, failing the drugs test, going to prison, it's all in the paper. You think, oh my God, you know, what's going to happen? Time will sort them things out. Just do whatever you need to do. As time goes, it's a healer. And look up in 2 months from now, you'll feel a little bit better about things.
Yes, brother. Listen, Paddy, boy, for coming on today and telling your story, brother. Listen, God bless you. Good guy.
Thank you.
I'll come down to your fight in March as well.
Definitely. Ringside, lad, for tickets.
How can people get your social media links?
So I'm on Twitter, just Paddy Lacey on Twitter and on Instagram. Type that in and I'll come up.
Sweet, brother. God bless.
Thank you, James Diamond.
Cheers, bro.
Appreciate that, lad.